And question, we're now moving on to questions to the Minister of Employment and Learning. And question one has been withdrawn, so I call Mr. Sidney Anderson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Question two.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And with your permission, I wish to group questions 2 and 12. Ulster University's decision to close its School of Modern Languages is the outworking of the budget cuts to my department and the higher education sector. As a result of these cuts, Ulster University has sought to rationalise its course offerings across campuses, and this has resulted in the decision to close some courses and to consolidate others. The University has advised that in making these decisions, a number of factors have been taken into consideration, including student demand, attrition rates, student satisfaction, employment statistics and research performance. Consolidation of teaching provision across all campuses will facilitate budgetary savings without impacting on the quality of teaching, which remains paramount. The level of interest and demand from students choosing modern language subjects at Ulster University is low, both in terms of the number of students who select modern language as a first choice and in terms of those who meet the requirements of the course. While I acknowledge the concern amongst business and other stakeholders regarding access to modern language courses in terms of the language skills required by the workforce, the further education colleges are well positioned to help meet the demand for modern language learning in Northern Ireland at the level needed. There is also potential for my department to give consideration to the provision of a business language academy through the Assured Skills Programme. However, this is dependent upon an identified need by a group of employers where the availability of language skills is impeding the growth of a particular sector.
Thank you, and I call Mr. Anderson for a supplement.
Thank you, and I thank the Minister for that response. Minister, local firms have said that modern language skills are crucial for the development and growth of business. And the Chief Executive of the Northern Ireland Chamber of Commerce, Anne McGregor, has described the closure of modern languages school at Ulster University as a setback for exporters. In light of the importance to our economy of countries such as China and Germany, does the Minister agree with me that it is vital that both these languages are taught at university level in Northern Ireland, and does he also agree with me that failure to offer such courses will simply add to the brain drain?
Well, I think we need to be slightly cautious in terms of the latter points that the member is making, in the sense that there have been issues raised around the viability of the school to begin with, and that's reflected in the decision-making process that has been involved by the university. But overall, and taking on board the comments that have been made by the Chamber of Commerce and other business organisations, it is worth reflecting upon that none of what we're doing around higher education makes a huge amount of sense. It doesn't make any sense at all, to be perfectly frank. And obviously that includes what we're doing around modern languages. I think we would all prefer it to be differently, but we haven't followed through with our actions in terms of having a more realistic approach to budget setting as an executive, and in turn what comes through to my department. So therein lies the difficulty where we find ourselves today. What we can do in terms of mitigation, and indeed this may improve to be a more effective way of addressing the particular language skills required by businesses, looking to the further education sector and also to the potential for a particular academy to be created where demand exists under the Assured Skills programme. And it is important to bear in mind that there can be a difference between the teaching of languages in a very academic context that you would find in a university and what are maybe the more practical selective requirements of business in terms of the ability to engage in sales and marketing with a particular eye to exports.
And I call Mr. Jim Wells.
I understand that sackcloth and ashes are the order of the day. I've just realised that I missed question 2 to OFM DFM. I got slightly confused between the two sets of questions. I wish to apologise to you and the House for that. Minister, some of my close relatives are Swiss. And when I visit them, I have to say that it's appalling to compare the capabilities of the Swiss people with European languages compared to graduates from our own part of this part of Europe. Surely we're sending out the totally wrong signal to industrialists and investors to say that instead of expanding modern languages and its education throughout the province, we're actually cutting back. Surely in an attempt to increase our markets throughout Europe, this is a totally wrong thing to do.
Well, several things I would say to the member. First of all, the fact that we're cutting our higher education sector in Northern Ireland is what is the heart of the negative message that we're sending out to the rest of the world. We do need to be very mindful of how important our base in terms of our universities and the skilled graduates that we are producing is to invest Northern Ireland's narrative as to how they are successful in attracting investment into Northern Ireland. So there are some very real dangers in that regard. Obviously, what we're doing around languages is one subset of that. In that regard, I have already mentioned to Mr. Anderson that the further education sector and indeed a potential academy approach may well be able to address the very particular requirements of the business community in terms of languages itself. Whenever the member makes a comparison to Switzerland as well, it's useful to also reflect that in Switzerland they have a different approach to higher level skills as an economy, and they actually have a much smaller higher education sector than us in terms of per capita participation, but they have a much more advanced system of higher level vocational skills. And without necessarily wanting to diminish what we're doing around higher education in Northern Ireland, we have drawn very heavily from the colleagues in Switzerland in terms of designing our own system of apprenticeships, including higher level apprenticeships in Northern Ireland.
Thank you. And I come to John Dellett.
Mr. Speaker, I've listened very carefully to the Minister. He's made reference twice to the further education colleges taking up the slack created by the Ulster University abandoning courses in modern languages. Perhaps he might detail more elaborately what consultation and discussions he's had with the College of Further Education, what additional resources he is making available to them. And finally, can I squeeze in, has he had any discussions with the Minister for Education as to the knock-on effect the abandonment of modern languages will have in our schools throughout Northern Ireland?
Well, I've had some discussions with the Minister of Education, primarily around the Irish language issue, which we're going to come to shortly. In terms of further education itself, they are very clear in terms of their own mission about supporting the local economy. And as the member will appreciate, we're currently finalising a new further education strategy for Northern Ireland, which will consolidate a lot of the progress that has been made in recent years in that regard. And while the colleges are certainly up for the challenge in this regard, I think we need to be realistic about the prospect of directing more resources to them. Resources are very scarce at present, and the prospect is that resources may get scarcer in the future before the situation improves.
I call Mr. Adrian Cochrane-Watson.
Mr. Speaker, in view of the Minister's comments in FA, I would just like to ask, would he agree with me that there's not the, or could he elaborate on the capacity and ability and indeed available funding for the FE sector to take up the challenge of modern languages delivery? Because the drastic cuts have already made significant cutbacks in their criteria for students already?
Well, that question does tend just to follow on or to reinforce what Mr. Dellett has said, and again, just in terms of taking the answer further, there are no good answers in this regard, short of actually having a more responsible approach across the board to our public finances. We're not in a situation where we can make more money available to further education. Of course, the further education sector themselves are already battling with cuts and have had to make very significant savings themselves in terms of this year's budget and are looking ahead, like other parts of the public sector, with great concern as to what may be happening in the future. So we do need to get our priorities right. And I'm very clear that we have to be investing in skills across a very broad front if we are to truly transform our economy. But quite sadly, we're going in the opposite direction, where we're currently defunding both our colleges and universities. So we can't simply sort of say, well, if cutbacks are happening in universities, then we'll put more resources into further education. That's just not realistic. But we have to make do with what we have at present and deliver things more efficiently and effectively, and at the same time make the case for more resources in terms of future years' budget allocations.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Adrian McCullen.
This site is owned by the University of Ulster. The University advised in July 2009 that the site was surplus to requirements and that planning permission for residential use had been obtained. It was proposed that the site be offered for sale at an appropriate time, with all the proceeds being reinvested in the university's core business. The university has advised me that the position has not changed.
And call Mr McQuillan first.
Thanks, Mr Speaker. Minister, could I ask you, could a portion of this site be used for a new site for Millstrand Integrated Primary School? They're in desperate need of a site in that area, and there's no green space at all, only that site.
At a personal level, I'd be more than happy to see the school getting new premises. Ultimately, those are conversations to be had between the Education Authority and the University, and I'm sure, not least on the back of the comments made by the member, that those conversations can take place.
And I call Mr Cahill-O'Hushin.
Like others, I too would support the relocation of Millstrand Integrated Primary School, although I don't believe that that site would be necessarily their first choice. But if that is not to be, the Minister will be aware that with the Open coming up in 2019, that there will be a demand on hotel accommodation within that area, and perhaps would agree with me that that might be a consideration.
I'm happy to concur with the member that that, again, may well be a useful way of looking at the future of the site, but I should stress these aren't matters for me or for the department. This is for the university to take forward, and again, I'm sure that the university will pick up the comments made by the member and continue efforts to explore a more productive use for the site than what is the current situation.
Thank you. And I call Mr Peter Weir.
My department is continuing to process final claims from projects originally funded as part of the European Social Fund between 2007 and 2013. The majority of organisations have now received full payment under the programme. My department has brought on board additional staff to further assist this process and to ensure that it is completed as soon as possible. I am pleased to report that 66 projects under the 2014-20 programme are now fully up and running. Many of the projects have been operational since April, while some other EU-funded programmes from the 2014-20 funding round, both here and in other parts of the UK, have yet to initiate their application processes. In order to ease cash flow issues for the new projects, I have agreed to my department implementing an interim measure whereby 50% of the ESF and DEL contribution in unpaid claims is paid now and vouched later. Applying this process has alleviated initial financial pressures which the projects have experienced, whilst work continues apace to ensure that all claims are fully vouched in line with audit requirements. In tandem with this, the department has brought further staff into the European Social Fund Managing Authority on a temporary basis in order to assist with the vouching of all claims. I am confident that this combination of short-term measures has gone a significant way to addressing the backlog of claims and will soon bring the Managing Authority to a position whereby it can efficiently vouch each individual claim as and when it arrives.
Thank the Minister for his response so far. Can I ask the Minister to outline what meetings he intends to have, or further meetings he intends to have, with groups that are still impacted by the problems of ESF funding?
Well, at this stage, I'm open to groups who wish to get in touch with me and to ask for meetings, and we will look to facilitate those. Obviously, my officials will interact with groups on an ongoing basis as well, and also the Managing Authority collectively meets with groups as well to discuss problems. So there are a whole range of different avenues through which we have an ongoing dialogue with the groups that are benefiting from the European Social Fund.
Mr. Robin Swan.
Could I ask the Minister to update the House in regard to the two judicial reviews that are currently being taken against the Department in regard to the European Social Fund?
Strictly speaking, those judicial reviews aren't at the point yet where they are being taken against the Department, and that remains to be seen over the coming weeks. We obviously will defend our position in the event of any challenge. I'm certainly confident around the procedures that have been deployed by my department and officials over the incoming 2014 2019-2020 period, though obviously we're always happy to learn lessons in terms of how things can be done better. And so obviously we're in the hands in terms of the process, but I stress to the member it remains to be seen how in practice anything actually transpires in that regard.
And I call Ms Karen McKevitt.
Mr Speaker, can I ask the Minister of the groups, is there any outstanding monies for these groups still there? I know you talked about sort of you were paying now and the groups were applying later sort of approach to it, but is there still monies that groups have applied for and programmes going on that they haven't received?
Two different processes in play. One is the closure of the outgoing 2007-2013 period, and the member will know we put in place a number of measures at the beginning of July to accelerate the closure of that programme, and good progress has been made in that regard, and we're down hopefully to the final outstanding payments in that respect, and hopefully that will be cleared up before the end of this calendar year. The second aspect is the flow of resource to those projects in terms of the incoming programme between 2014-2020. And as I set out in the answer, the main answer, that we have put in place a process of accelerated payments in terms of 50% contribution towards unpaid claims, which in effect we pay now and vouch later, and we're happy to do that at our risk, and that's a fairly low risk approach for us to be taken. Hopefully that system, that delay in the system will work itself out over the coming months, and we'll be back into a level playing field in terms of addressing claims as they come in.
And I call Ms Anna Lowe.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Can I ask the Minister, what impact is ESF having on communities across Northern Ireland?
Well, I think it is important to recognise that, first of all, the point I made in the main answer itself, that we actually have the European Social Fund for 2014 and 2020 up and running, and we managed that as well without any break in terms of coverage, albeit it was rather tight in terms of the end of March into the beginning of April. But that was a very tight turnaround in terms of the timescales provided to us by the European Commission in terms of clearance of our operational programme. But it is worth noting that we are well ahead of many other parts of the European Union in terms of having our European Social Fund up and running, and certainly we stand in very good place compared to the situation indeed elsewhere in the UK. Of course, the European Social Fund itself makes a massive contribution towards the provision of skills and bringing people closer to the labour market across Northern Ireland. And I am pleased that we have 66 projects up and running. We have a commitment over the next 3 years where in excess of £110 million euros is due to be spent in terms of what we're doing in terms of support for the community and voluntary sector and others in terms of supporting people, particularly those who are most marginalised from the labour market and low skilled, to better improve their life opportunities.
Thank you. And I call Mr Pat Sheehan.
Question 5, please.
Mr Speaker, with your permission, I wish to group questions 5 and 7. As a result of the budget cuts to my department, Ulster University has sought to rationalise its course offerings across campuses. This has resulted in the decision to close some courses and to consolidate others. This includes the consolidation of Irish courses at McGee campus. A bachelor's degree in Irish language and literature will continue to be offered at the Belfast campus as a part-time study option. The university has advised that in making these decisions, a number of factors have been taken into consideration, including student demand, attrition rates, student satisfaction, employment statistics and research performance. Consolidation of teaching provision across all campuses will facilitate budgetary savings without impacting on the quality of teaching, which remains paramount.
Well, Mr Sheehan for supplement.
Thank the Minister for his answer. Does the Minister agree with me that Belfast's reputation as the Irish language capital of Ireland has been built on the phenomenal foundation of the Ulster University in York Street? And does he accept that it's a blow to the city and to its reputation for this course to be ended?
Well, it's important to clarify, first of all, that the course hasn't been ended. The university have sought to consolidate what is their full-time provision in terms of Irish language at the McGee campus in Derry, and not without wishing to intrude in terms of internal Sinn Féin politics, but I was under the impression that people were very keen to see the expansion of the university in McGee, and certainly to build up McGee's impact in terms of how it takes forward a number of courses. And obviously McGee is not that far from Belfast, and as we expect students to travel to McGee for a whole range of other courses, particularly as courses are consolidated, then the provision in terms of Irish language shouldn't be any different. Of course, it would be nice to have a situation where the full-time provision was available in both Belfast and in Derry, and the member will be fully aware of the context in which these decisions have been taken in terms of the cuts to the higher education budget. In the context of an improved situation, I would hope that the approach from the university could be reconsidered, and we could see the restoration of some full-time provision of terms of Irish language in Belfast. And obviously, as we look to the development of, for example, a Gaeltacht quarter in Belfast, there is a certain logic and synergy that could be developed in that regard. But I certainly wouldn't be disparaging about the fact that course provision is going to Derry. I also encourage the member to recognise the very difficult decisions that the university have been taking, and the fact that they have, in the main, preserved Irish language provision overall.
Thank you. I'll call Mr. Edmund.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Is it not the case, Minister, that your department has had to deal with very severe cuts in its funding, not least because £10 million a month of fines were being paid back to Westminster as a result of the failure to implement the Stormont House Agreement and welfare reform? And thus, this is a consequence. The cuts to the Irish language budgets, the cuts to the Irish language at universities, is a direct consequence of Sinn Féin's own actions in ensuring that those fines are being sent to Westminster instead of being spent on universities.
Well, I would concur with the member in the main in that we are in a very serious situation around our public finances. We do need to have much more financial responsibility, and that does start with the resolution around the situation in welfare reform and the cessation of money leaking out of Northern Ireland and through welfare fines. And obviously the consequence of that has been some very serious consequences in terms of our higher education provision. But it's worth stressing again that in terms of what has happened, the Irish language provision has actually escaped the axe. What has happened is we have seen a consolidation of provision in Derry rather than the situation where split between Belfast and Derry. And that is, I think, a situation that people should take a degree of comfort from, particularly those who are Irish language enthusiasts, because the university has sought to preserve what has happened. In terms of the consolidation, that means that they, across the board, consolidation means that less money is actually spent in terms of overheads, which allows them to do more to try to maximise the number of student places that are retained in what is otherwise a very serious situation where places are being lost.
I call Mr. Basil McRae.
Thank you, Speaker. Minister, given that the University of Ulster receives 40% of its funding from your department and a significant amount of the balance from student loans, which would also have a government bias, do you think it is appropriate that you should be more directive in telling the universities what studies they should be delivering and in which campus?
No, I don't. I think we need to show a degree of caution in terms of how government seeks to micromanage what happens in terms of whether it's universities or whether it's the education sector, whether it's hospitals, the health service, whether it's museums, whether it's sporting organisations, whether it's arts organisations. We have to have what is a pluralist society in in this country. We have to respect the fact that we employ professionals and also recognise that civil servants are there, ministers are there to take broad-based decisions around policy and resources, but in doing so we recognise that we have, whether it's NDPBs in the case of other situations or in the context of universities, what are actually formally autonomous bodies, and actually trust those who are professionally qualified to take the decisions as to how best to make decisions with scarce resources and to invest in courses that are relevant to the future of our economy and are having an impact in terms of the further development of our society.
Thank you. And it comes to Stephen Moultrie.
Question number six, Mr. Speaker.
My department is committed to ensuring that anyone over 19 years of age with learning difficulties or disabilities and who can benefit from available provision can avail of the opportunities on offer. This offer includes a range of education skills and employment provisions such as training for success, apprenticeships, further and higher education programmes funded through the European Social Fund, careers guidance and employment support services. In addition to current provision, in recent times I initiated a number of strategic approaches which cumulatively will enhance our provision for those who are post-19 and deliver improved support and services. These include the outworking of the review of career support, the implementation of the new youth training strategy, generating success, the further education strategy and employment and skills strategy for people with disabilities, delivery of a wide range of support services under the new European Social Fund programmes and the new economic and activity strategy. These initiatives will put in place additional and improved provision which young people with learning difficulties or disabilities can access to achieve their education, skills and employment goals. Furthermore, my department chairs a cross-departmental group which has been considering current gaps in provision and opportunities for making improvements to services for young people with severe learning difficulties or disabilities, making the transition from school into adult services. The work of this group has resulted in a Transitions Action Plan which sets out a range of proposed actions across government that aim to deliver improved support for people post-19 with severe learning disabilities. The Action Plan, which was agreed in May 2015, will be monitored by the Bamford Interdepartmental Senior Officials Group, which will report to the Ministerial Group. My department will be responsible for collating the necessary information and updates from relevant lead departments in order to assess progress.
And a call, Mr. Stephen Moultrie.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his response. The Minister will be aware, no doubt, of the angst that often comes to families of children with special needs whenever it comes to they come to 19 and have to leave their special schools. In that respect, can I ask him, has he consulted with schools like Sierra in Lurgan and Donard and Banbridge, both in my upper band constituency, in relation to issues like this?
Well, first of all, can I identify with the sentiment that the member has outlined in terms of the real difficulties and fears that families experience in terms of the transition from special school into adult services. And it's often described as people essentially walking off a cliff in terms of the certainty to a very uncertain situation. And it's in that context that we have this action plan in place to better advise in terms of what the services that are available across a range of provision, whether it's in terms of the Department of Health through to my own department in terms of the further education sector and also employment opportunities. There are often gaps between what departments can offer, and it's important that we use the strategy and the action plan to try to close those particular gaps. Obviously, the Department of Education is an important partner in this regard, and while I personally have not had a discussion with the particular schools that the member makes reference to, it is the responsibility of the Department of Education to be engaging with those schools and to reflect back their particular experiences and concerns into the civil service group and also the ministerial group as we try to take forward the action plan. But obviously, proper signposting to the available services and also identification of gaps and trying to overcome those gaps will be critical aspects of the work that we take forward.
Thank you. And I call Ms. Joanne Dobson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can I ask what assurances can the Minister give that the reduction in college places will not adversely affect those young people with special education needs entering further education and indeed those already progressing in community and off-campus provision? And Minister, you're aware of the particular concerns in my own constituency of Upper Ban.
Well, what I can say to the member is that we have sought to protect those places in terms of the cuts that have been made to the further education sector this year. And that will certainly be my intention as we look to further years as well, because I do recognise the importance of this provision and how important it is, and indeed how families rely on that. It's also important to recognise that during my term in office, we have had a 50% increase in resources available through the additional support fund for students in further education. So that commitment also remains very much in place. Thirdly, we're also taking forward the public consultation now on a new employment strategy for people with disabilities. And again, that's a fresh commitment that we're making. And that we are privileged to have the support from a whole range of community and voluntary sectors, particularly those who are funded through the European Social Fund, who are very much our partners in terms of the delivery of that strategy once it's formally agreed in the new year.
Good, and thank you, Minister. That ends the period for listed questions, and we now move on to 15 minutes of topical questions, and I call Ms. Paula Bradley.
Mr. Speaker, can I ask the Minister what action his department has taken to address the employee gaps within the construction sector?
Well, we first of all work very closely with the construction employers in that regard, and obviously CITB is a non-departmental public body in relation to my own department. The member will also be aware that we're taking forward new strategies in terms of apprenticeships and youth training. We're working towards a sectoral partnership for the construction sector, whereby they can identify the very particular training requirements that they need, and also work in partnership with the colleges and other training providers around the creation of a refreshed curriculum in terms of what is required to ensure that the sector can continue to flourish in Northern Ireland.
And I call Ms. Paula Bradley for a supplement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank the Minister for his answer. I was recently at a meeting with Helm Housing in Rathcote Housing Estate, looking at a new development there, and some of the issues they brought up were around social clauses and also around apprenticeships, and they had been working with Northern Regional College to try and address some of those. They had found that quite problematic, so I just want to ask your assessment on the further education colleges and placements within construction sites. How good has that been to date, and how can that be improved upon?
Well, obviously the member will be aware we're moving from the outgoing system in terms of training for success and previously programme-led apprenticeships, which may be at the heart of sometimes the tensions that have existed in terms of finding placements, because that hasn't always gone as smoothly as had been the hope in the past. Under the new systems, that situation should be improved, because we are going to see a much stronger focus in terms of employer-led advice in terms of where particular training is required, rather than the sector themselves perhaps guessing where it is. I am conscious, however, that our situation in Northern Ireland is turning around, and we're now seeing that in terms of people expressing concerns about the future pipeline of talent. We are committed to working very closely with the FE colleges. We have a very strong track record in terms of what they do in terms of support of construction. And in some ways, that's actually exemplified by the stunning success that Northern Ireland has had in skill competitions, most recently World Skills. And to put this in context, the Northern Ireland basically managed to achieve 40% of the entire UK medals in World Skills in Sao Paulo in Brazil in August of this year. And indeed, Gary Doyle, who was a former student at Southern Regional College, won the gold medal and is essentially now the world's best plumber. So that's a great accolade, and really does show that the real effort that colleges are making in terms of investing in construction skills, that we're achieving that level of success.
I call Ms. Bronwyn McGahan.
Is the Minister aware of the startling figures in my constituency that state that regarding those aged 16 plus living in Five Mile Town, that almost 42% of residents have no academic or professional qualifications? And similar figures for neighbouring areas state that Clogher is almost 40%, Annacloy is almost 37%, and Ballygally is almost 35%. And if the Minister is not aware, can he give these alarmingly high figures his attention?
I agree with the member that those figures are alarming, but I regret to say that those will be reflected in many other parts of Northern Ireland as well. I mean, we do have some major issues in terms of underachievement, in terms of our education system, and we have stark problems in terms of those with low or no levels of qualifications. That's why it's so important that we are investing across a very broad front in terms of educational opportunities and training. opportunities. Obviously, there's a role for the Department of Education, which the member's colleague is the minister, and obviously there's a role for my department to play. So it's important that we have a joined-up strategy that bridges the two departments. We have seen this progression between school and training opportunities, including the new system of youth training and apprenticeships, and through to further education and higher education. And also we have early warning of those who are likely to leave school without any formal qualifications, so we're able to put in place measures to try to capture those and to see what other techniques we can deploy to try to ensure that they do get on the first rung of the ladder in terms of skills and qualifications.
I call Mr. Roy Biggs. Oh, sorry, Ms. McGahan for a supplementary. I beg your pardon.
Gourmet Ogut, and I thank the Minister for his response, and I do commend the Minister in the efforts that he's making to tackle the skills deficit here in the North. But can the Minister outline what measures and actions he can take immediately to deal with this alarming problem in a rural area where proximity to services appears to be the problem in terms of improving prospects for those local people in relation to providing support?
Yeah, well, we can offer some limited support in terms of transport, in terms of further education, depending upon people's personal situation, obviously through applying with their local college, which would be South West College, in the case of the areas that the member is mentioning. But ultimately, this does require resources, and the more resources that we have, then the more we're able to invest in these types of interventions. For example, we have currently a NEET strategy, Pathways to Success, for which there's no effective budget. That budget essentially expired at the end of March 2015. I would have hoped that it would have been renewed in different circumstances, but it was one of the first things that was dropped whenever the executive was trying to wrestle with balancing its own particular budget. We also have an economic and activity strategy, which has been agreed by the executive in April of this year, which again hasn't been commenced because of the absence of resources. So we have essentially two strategies which are sitting on the shelf at present, which we could activate if we had the resources, which would directly benefit the members' constituents in the particular circumstances that she mentions.
And a comment to Roy Biggs.
Last week, Minister, we learned that private sector employment was increasing in every sector in Northern Ireland except for the private sector manufacturing. So can the Minister advise us how he and his department proactively monitor the needs and the demand for skills, craftsmen and women, such as fitters and welders, in order to meet the demand that does exist within the manufacturing industry going forward to maintain current demand, but also enable them to develop and meet the needs of further demand in the future?
Well, in that regard, I should say that I chair a working group for engineering and advanced manufacturing, which brings together business organisations, our colleges, our universities, and a representative sample of employers. We have an action plan which examines the different skill requirements, and that action plan is something that we do seek to update on a regular basis. There is a strong pipeline in terms of skills. There's obviously more that we need to do in that regard, but opportunities also depend upon the underlying economic climate in Northern Ireland as well, and that in turn is affected by what's happening in terms of the wider global economy as well. So it is difficult and challenging times in terms of manufacturing. Obviously, we've had some very difficult and troubling announcements made in terms of recent weeks and indeed over the past couple of years. But I think it is important that we do continue to talk about the underlying strength in terms of manufacturing in Northern Ireland, and the fact that we have a critical number of world-class businesses that really are making major contributions, and indeed who are exporting beyond Northern Ireland to other markets.
And Mr. Biggs for supplementary.
Last week, myself and my colleague Robin Swan visited Larne Skills Development, where we learnt of their quite remarkable 96% success rate in moving trainees into full-time employment by working closely with private sector companies and meeting their needs. So one of the issues raised to us was that the demographics amongst the welding community, in the next 10 years, a very high proportion of welders will be approaching their retirement age. So the question specifically to the Minister, how is that demographics being addressed, and will he be ensuring that we will not be reaching a situation where there are vacancies for key skills where gainful employment could be made and that the skills will be developed to meet the needs of the industry?
In that regard, obviously, the further education sector itself can respond to requirements from employers and where there are particular gaps. The member will also be interested to know that next week we're launching, this week we're launching Northern Ireland's first skills barometer, which takes down to a more granular level where we are going to be seeing particular pressure points emerge in terms of our economy. So that advice will be there to help policymakers and also those in charge of resources to use them much more efficiently and effectively, as well as advising those in terms of taking career decisions. On the specific subject of welding, I should also point out that through both Belfast Metropolitan College and Northern Regional College, that we have invested in welding academies, particularly to assist Harland Wolff to ensure that they have a strong stream of people who are skilled in the very particular aspect of welding that is required in terms of working on oil rigs, which is a very highly skilled and a very lucrative occupational area.
And I call Mr. Phil Flanagan.
Minister, it was my understanding from consideration within the committee that Steps to Success was a purely voluntary scheme for participants, but it has subsequently transpired that it's actually mandatory for people aged 18 to 24 after 9 months and for people aged 25 plus after 12 months. Can the Minister give us an indication as to when that policy decision was taken, or was that the purpose of Steps to Success all along?
I'm not entirely sure at what stage the member was under the impression that this was going to be a purely voluntary process. That was never the undertaking given by either me or my officials at any stage in terms of the development of Steps to Success. And it's worth referencing that Steps to Success is a fresh programme that has replaced Steps to Work. And that process of referral to Steps to Work was in place long before Steps to Success was actually considered. Now, Steps to Success does seek to learn some positive lessons from Steps to Work and has also taken on board some of the implications of how work programmes have been taken forward elsewhere in the UK, and allows us to have in place a very Northern Ireland orientated system that meets our particular circumstances and has a much more focused approach around the needs of the individual and ensuring that everyone is assisted in terms of their search for work. But I am slightly puzzled as to why the member ever thought this was a purely voluntary participatory programme.
Well, Mr. Flanagan.
The Minister for his answer, but he'll establish me in puzzlement later. Can I ask the Minister whether he actually believes that Steps to Success is a worthwhile programme? Because I want to quote some of the statistics here. There have been 21,000 participants since up until June 2015, but only 1,500 did so voluntarily. That's less than 9%. And that's at a total cost of £14 million to your department. Can I ask the Minister to actually tell us whether he thinks it's a worthwhile scheme or whether his department's merely implementing a lightened version of the work programme that has been so ridiculed in England?
Well, obviously, the member will be aware that in terms of things like Job Seekers Allowance, there is a degree of conditionality around that. That's something that's out of our hands. So it's important that we do respond to the situation where people are in long-term unemployment. So if we don't have a programme in place, then we have a vacuum in terms of the offering made by my department or indeed any other successor department in terms of addressing those people who are long-term unemployed. We have sought to ensure that what we have put in place is designed to meet the particular circumstances of Northern Ireland. That is one of the attractions of devolution, one of the benefits of devolution. If we hadn't had devolution, we would have had the same as a Britain work programme in place in Northern Ireland, same as has Scotland and Wales have had, given the fact that employment matters are not devolved in those particular contexts. And through putting in place our own programme, we have actually sought to be much more sympathetic to the direct needs of our own economy and to ensure that we are treating everyone as an individual and understanding their particular requirements in terms of investing in skills and trying to avail of employment opportunities. It is important that we try to help people out of unemployment It is not a situation that they themselves want to be in, and it's not a situation that's good for our society. And I've met very, very few people who actually actively want to be unemployed. So people aren't moving into steps of success with any sense of compulsion. It is something that is technically mandatory, but it is seen as an opportunity for people to try to transform their lives.
And time is up. And thank you very much, Minister.